Good morning. My name is Reverend George Rizor. I'm the pastor of Holy Trinity United Church of Christ in Willingboro, New Jersey. I want to welcome you to this virtual worship, this time of gathering and being in God's presence, wherever we may be, however scattered we may be, being the community of God. As these people of Holy Trinity. It is November 29th, 2020. It is the first Sunday of Advent. In case you didn't know that last week was Thanksgiving or that Christmas is this close, I want to welcome you, and I pray that this day is meaningful and powerful for you because it is the Lord's day and the Lord's time. Our centering words and thoughts for worship on this day. Advent is a time of waiting, a time to open our hearts to God's presence, a time to pay attention to God's call, and a time to be filled with hope. God's love breaks in over and over again. Be awake, for God is near. The words that call us together in worship today are as follows. You alone, O Lord, are God. Come down, O God. You have done wonderful things in the past. Come down, O God. We need you here with us now. Come down, O God. We wait for you. We wait with hope.
And now, whatever you are doing, whatever your state of mind, wherever you are in your faith journey, whatever is going on in your mind and heart, I invite you to take a faith-filled minute to share aloud our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
We come now to our time of our coffee warm-up music. This is your time. It is the time that I invite you to warm up your coffee if you are, to nibble a bite of toast, but more important, it is a time to center, to reflect, and during this time of worship, to know that God is good.
Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hands the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes.
Come now to our time of prayer of confession. This is the only time during the worship service that I invite you to do a responsive reading. I will share the phrases and words of the prayer and invite you to responsively speak those words. You call us to wait, to watch, to be ready. But we are so easily distracted, busily doing other things. We grow drowsy and complacent. Give us wisdom. as we prepare for your coming. Amen. And now I invite you to take just a few seconds to consider our confession and God's redemption and grace. God is the potter who shapes our lives. God is the parent who loves us. Into God's presence we come, and from that presence we are forgiven, blessed, and sustained. Amen. We share now our Holy Trinity announcements. We make a real concerted effort to be community, to be in touch with all of the wonderful people of our beloved Holy Trinity community. One of the ways that we do that is the sermon by phone. Holy Trinity Scripture and Sunday Sermon is available by telephone all week 24/7 following Sunday's worship service. You can just call the number and listen to the Scripture and each Sunday's sermon. The number is 856-203-6424. I invite you to listen in, but let's be honest. More important, I invite you to share with anyone who doesn't have access to the computer, who hasn't heard one of our virtual worship. Share the phone number and invite them to join us for Sermon by Phone, 856-203-6424. Next Sunday is Communion Sunday. You are invited to share or to join us for communion during our virtual worship. And it is, in fact, let's remember the symbolism of the Lord's Supper. So you're invited to use any food and drink as we join together in communion time. That's the first Sunday of each month.
Lord, every knee shall Christ is Lord.
Because it is Advent, we will not be seeing and hearing the picture themes of the weeks, but instead we will take this time for our Advent candle lighting. We are waiting in the dark of the year. We are waiting. We are waiting for the potter to shape our lives. We are waiting to see clearly what lies hidden in darkness. We are waiting, awake and alert, ready for God to come. In the darkness, a candle is lit. The light comforts our waiting. The light reminds us of the one who has come. I want to thank all of the folks who are joining us for the candle lighting for the Advent season this year. Many thanks to you for those who have volunteered for our candle lighting. And if you want to volunteer or for a candle lighting or for a reading, please let me know. Advent 2020. Today's Advent candle is hope. Many thanks to Bill McGurran, who's going to be our Advent candle lighter for this day.
We light a candle representing hope. Let the light from this candle show us the bright hope of the baby in the manger, our hope of the beloved community of God.
It is a community. Holy Trinity is a community. And so, as a community, I want to invite you to share as a community. Emails, texts, social media posts, phone calls, photos, news, prayer requests. Let's be community. I want to hear from you as community. Birthday notices, anniversary news, anything at all like that. Please email me with any requests at george.riser@gmail.com, or you can send mail to the church address via the U.S. Postal Service. That's at Holy Trinity Box 2249, Willingboro 08046. And now, as we celebrate community, and as we prepare to pray together, our celebration music, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus.
Let us find our rest.
we come now with our concerns, our thanksgiving, our praise, our celebrations, our joys, and our intercessions. Please let me know if you want to or need to lift up someone in prayer by adding them to the prayer list, or if an ongoing request can be removed from the list or the screens. You can email me, you can send me postal mail. Excuse me. We continue to lift up in prayer a nation that is divided, that is healing, in need of prayer as a result of the evils of racism, the dangers and the horrible cost of racism. We also lift up in prayer, we continue to lift up in prayer Marge's sister Jean, as well as prayers of celebration. The procedure that she had this past week went well, and her back pain has been reduced significantly, so we certainly are thankful for that prayer of good results. We this is a kind of a personal prayer request. Prayers of celebration for the wonderful Thanksgiving gathering, a whole batch of folks from the church gathering via Zoom on Thanksgiving morning at 11 o'clock. Just a wonderful time, as the cliche goes, a good time was had by all. It was just wonderful to see everybody gathered together. We lift up those who are doing readings or candle lightings for the virtual worship, for all of the community members who are participating. Many thanks to all of you who are helping with Advent preparations. Also, the numbers that I heard just this morning on the news are just horrific. Let's pray for vaccine and news related to vaccine, but let's continue to lift up those who are impacted by the COVID-19 virus. 13.3 million victims just in this particular screen that's on the worship service right now was 256,000 last week, 10,000 deaths, 266,000 deaths, 10,000 just from last week's screen to this screen. Let's please keep our world, our nation in prayer as we deal with the COVID-19. Please join with me in a time of prayer. Loving and gracious God, when the days grow longer, casting long and cold shadows and allow fear or despair to creep into our lives, let our light shine brighter. May we look to you with adoration and devotion when the task grows more wearisome, filling valleys and flattened mountains and building highways in the desert. Be the strength in our bones. Be our shield and our portion. When we wait on you and the world shakes its head and says, "Have you not heard the news?" may we entrust to our hearts and keep in our hearts the great good news that makes even the child in the womb leap with joy, that you are coming into the world. May we praise you in shadow as well as in light. May we praise you in winter as well as in spring. May we praise you in silence as well as in song. May we praise you in solitude as well as in companionship. And when the quickening happens and the Advent gives way to nativity, we embrace the light and the love. Give us the grace to say to all, this is Christ the Lord. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Amen. And now we not only come to God with our concerns and with our joys, but also with our efforts for the people of God. Contributions for those in need, for the mission and the ministry of the church. Making a difference in God's holy name. In order to make a difference with your gifts, you're invited to giving, to tithes and offerings. You can send your gifts to Holy Trinity, United Church of Christ, Box 2249, Willingboro, New Jersey, 08046.
God, from whom all blessings flow, praise Him, all creatures here below, praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts, praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Now we turn to the word of the Lord in our scripture lessons. Our epistle lesson is from Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 1, verses 3 through 9. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you, because of the grace that God has given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in Him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By Him you were called into the fellowship of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Our gospel reading is from Mark's gospel, Mark 13, 24 through 37. But in those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened, and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then He will send out the angels and gather His elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour, no one knows, neither the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert, for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey when he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. May God bless the reading, hearing, the understanding, and acting upon this portion of God's holy and divine word. A young girl said to her Sunday school teacher, "I need to know the meaning of a word." "Oh," she said, "what word?" "Lurt," said the little girl. "What?" the teacher asked. "Lurt," she said. "Why do you want to know? Where did you hear that word?" asked the bewildered teacher. "Because the pastor said that we should be alert, so that I want to know what alert is, so I can be one." Jesus tells us to stay alert. Jesus is quite clear about his watching in this passage. Be vigilant. Be on watch. Watch for the kingdom of heaven. Jesus talks about the signs of the coming times. The sun will be darkened. The moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the heavens. The powers in heaven will shake. Jesus talks about the fig tree and knowing the signs of the season, and then tells a parable about a man who leaves his home and tells the doorkeeper to keep watch, to let him in when he returns again. So Jesus is adamant about us keeping watch. Keep awake. Keep alert to keep watch. But why? For what? Well, the day of the return of the Son of Man will happen. He will return, we are told. He will return with power and glory, and he will gather the elect. But what does that mean, and what is it that we watch for or keep watch for as we begin this Advent season? If someone were to say to you, this first Sunday of Advent in 2020, with our world and our nation and our society in the state it is, with Christmas less than a month away, what would you say is the crux of your faith? What is the meaning of your faith, and what is it that you are waiting for as you try to adhere to Jesus' instructions? What is the final goal, and what is the nature of our faith endeavors. What's the final goal? And boy, does this relate to us and speak to us in this time of pandemic, particularly those who have abandoned worship. Yeah, this is your pastor talking to you. Those who have abandoned worship as a result of pandemic times. Amen. Let's talk about our Christian faith and what it is that we're keeping watch for. What may be the beginning of the end? I'd like to suggest to you three possible time periods in keeping watch for different things, different signs and different goals and different lives and different spirituality in those three different time frames. And I'd like to relate first the Hebrew period prior to the birth of Jesus. Let's talk about what the Jews were waiting for prior to the birth of Jesus. They were waiting for the Messiah, the anointed one, the Savior, the liberator. The liberator. Make no mistake. The Jews were a distressed people. They were bound and they were oppressed and displaced or disenfranchised or enslaved or captive or abandoned or wandering lost without a homeland for centuries. And from all of that trouble and tribulation, the Jews wanted relief. But most of what we see in the Bible and history suggests that they were looking for a liberator. They wanted the Messiah to be a kingly leader in the category of Saul or David or even, could they dare to hope this, in the category of a Caesar for the Jews. They wanted not just delivered, but to be raised to their rightly place in the world, their place as the chosen people of God, their place at the top of the world pecking order, not at the bottom. And they waited for just that kind of military and worldly conqueror who would come into their world and help them to assume their right place as the paramount power of the world. And that's what they waited for. A Messiah who was a deliverer. They waited for a military conquest that would put Israel at the top of the world's power. Someone needed to come and make that happen. And that someone was who they were waiting for. They waited for a worldly solution to a worldly dilemma. Is that what we're waiting for in this Advent 2020? Is that what we think we need and what we're keeping watch for? A worldly solution to a worldly dilemma. Is that our concept of the kingdom of heaven? In fact, our Christian faith suggests that the awaited Messiah was a baby, born in a manger to poor Jewish kids who were pretty clueless about worldly power and governmental politics. They couldn't secure a room at the local Holiday Inn. That's how naive they were. But that's getting ahead in the story. We'll deal with that in about 4 weeks. So Jesus was born, grew, lived, and preached. A handful of itinerant religious enthusiasts followed him as this kind of grew and gained and become a fledgling cult. And then Jesus was killed by the governmental and religious leaders of the day, and the followers believe that he rose from the dead and assumed a heavenly authority to judge and to bring about the judgment end times. Now, many people think that that's what we're waiting for. What we're watching for are those end times. Some sort of cosmic resolution, some sort of cosmic retribution, if you were. Unfortunately, many folks believe Christianity to be a sort of break-even payback system. In the sweet by and by, all of your transgressions, all of your sins will be repaid by hellfire and brimstone, or at the very least, by a stern tongue lashing. My transgressions are so small and so insignificant that I'm not going to be subject to the same sort of punishment as the next person. And my enemies, well, wow, come the end times, they're really going to get it. History shows that many of the early church founders thought exactly that. Jesus returned to earth to establish a heavenly kingdom was going to happen quickly, and was going to even Steven things out. Jesus is coming soon, and he's not happy, and you're going to get yours. But the early church mothers and fathers believed that they had the inside track, that they knew that the coming would be in settled in their favor. And how long has that thinking prevailed? Well, have you listened to politicians and national religious leaders recently? Today? Have you listened to the appeal to self-serving and selfish and self-centered interests in our society today? The belief is alive and well this day. So, we have the early pre-Jesus thinking, we're waiting for a conqueror. Those who are watching and waiting for a worldly solution to a worldly problem. And we have the post-Jesus thinking, in both the early church founders and those who evidence that kind of thinking today. Those who are watching and waiting for divine end times, which will offer a divine retribution and divine retaliation. Those who are wrong and who are going to get what's coming to them. And we're finally going to get the blessings that we richly deserve. I think the problem with both of those perceptions is that we end up ignoring much of Jesus' teaching if we actually believe either of those positions. We fall very far short from the idea of the kingdom of heaven, very far indeed. So what should we be waiting for? What should we be watching for? What should we be our desire as we keep watch and wait for the fulfillment of Jesus' message. And in some sense, we can ask, what is it that we are waiting for this Advent? What is the meaning of the coming of Jesus? What is the meaning of Jesus' life? And what is it that we are keeping watch for? First, let me say that it won't be a worldly solution to a worldly problem. And it's not going to mean some sort of cosmic end time getting even. And it certainly isn't going to happen on our schedule. What then? What's the meaning of Jesus for in the current Advent season? Part of it is Christian maturity. I think that the mature Christian message and concept for this first Sunday of Advent 2020 is hope. Hope and reliance. Our faith today has to be rooted in hope, in faith in Jesus, and in the message of God in Jesus, and in the kingdom of heaven, and all that hope will eventually lead to. We need to be a new generation of the hopeful. A new generation of the hopeful. Now, if we're waiting and we're being alert and we're patiently watching, then we're going to be watching with hope. And we're going to be acting with hope. The hopeful will be trusting. The hopeful will be trusting. They won't need to look out for number one. They think about that this Christmas. Many of us are troubled and are under burdens. But if we're truly helpful and truly trusting, then we need to let go of the idea of looking out for number one. And we need to turn our lives with all of our troubles and turmoils and twists, we need to turn over to God. The hopeful will be trusting. The hopeful will be sharing. They will want to care for others. If we're not looking out for number one, that will be an excellent beginning for looking out for all of God's people, all of God's creation, those who are in need, those who are want, those who are ill, and so on. The hopeful will be trusting. The hopeful will be sharing. And the hopeful will be inclusive. They will want to share their faith and their good fortune in knowing Jesus. And they will want to share it with those beyond their normal circle of family and friends and acquaintances. We will want to reach out and embrace those who are not at the table. We will want to love and to care for those who are marginalized or disenfranchised or outcast. We, the hopeful, watching and waiting upon the Lord with hope, will try to touch those who are different or who are unloved or who are not incorporated in the body of the community. We will reach out those who have been ostracized by society because, and I hope this is true, we are children of God. We, the hopeful, the generation of hope, we behave better than society, we hope. The hopeful will be inclusive. The hopeful will love God and will love others. The love will be a very meaningful and a very real act this Advent season. Giving and sharing and loving can take on a more vibrant, a more urgent, and a more meaningful tone. Folks, I'm telling you this day that you really are special people. The hopeful will love beyond the world's capacity for imagining and understanding love. Finally, the hopeful will look toward a baby in a manger to bring the unbelievable gift of God. Is it any wonder that other religions can't begin to understand or intellectually embrace that which we have encountered or experience? God, the omnipotent, almighty creator of the universe, chose to reveal the power and the glory and the humanity, the humility, the power, the presence, and the very love of God through a baby in a manger. God incarnate, making the ultimate communication to God's people. God incarnate. The hopeful will believe an unlikely, amazing, and miraculous story about God's love. What are you waiting for this Advent season? What are you keeping watch for this Advent season? May part of what you watch for be hope. The hope of the season. A hope that will transcend the desires and the whims of the world. A hope that will be amazing and fulfilling and wonderful. I pray that our Advent actions will be actions born of hope. I pray that we can be a new generation of the hopeful. And I pray that the thing that we can be watching for and waiting for is love. Amen. In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti, amen. Stay awake, for God is coming. Prepare your heart, for God is near. In the darkness, a candle of hope burns brightly. In the quiet, God speaks to us. Go with joy and remain awake and aware. Grace and peace to you from God the Creator and from our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So be it. Amen.
Feels like fire. I'm so in love with you, hurt the soul. Make love your goal. The power of love, a force from above. Desire, love with tongues of fire.
Thank you.